listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KLCF 88.1 in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. The time is 8 o'clock. It's time for the Morning Mix. Stay tuned.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff in studio with Peter Phillips. Today's program, Nelson Mandela and the Legacy of Apartheid. We begin the hour in discussion with independent journalist and filmmaker Danny Schechter, author of Madiba A to Z, The Many Faces of Nelson Mandela, out now from Seven Stories Press. The second half of the program, Dr. Amer Arame joins us. He worked at the United Nations for 14 years to end apartheid in South Africa and has recently written about Mandela's legacy and the situation in Israel-Palestine.
All that right after the news.
I'm Cameron Jones with news headlines, sitting in for Eileen Alfandary. East African leaders say South Sudan's government today has agreed to end hostilities. The announcement raises hopes for a potential breakthrough in efforts to cease violence that has displaced more than 120,000 people in the world's newest country. Following a crisis summit in Kenya, the bloc of leaders called IGAD issued a statement welcoming a commitment by the South Sudanese government to cease hostilities. Ethiopian Foreign Minister Tedros Adhanom.
Any solution to this crisis should be through political dialogue. And the IGAD countries and the two leaders who are here will do their best to resolve this problem amicably.
Meanwhile, the number of internally displaced people continues to rise, with many seeking shelter at UN compounds across the country. Egyptian security forces fired tear gas and clashed with hundreds of supporters of ousted President Mohamed Morsi around the country today as authorities tightened security measures in the capital after Morsi's Muslim Brotherhood and its allies renewed calls for mass rallies. Anti-riot police chased student protesters chanting against the military and the police at the Islamic Al-Azhar University. Footage on private TV networks showed students hurling stones and setting fire to tree branches. At least two are dead after the government on Wednesday declared the Brotherhood a terrorist organization. An Egyptian official said any participants in Brotherhood rallies will be sentenced to 5 years in prison, and group's leaders could be sentenced to death, according to anti-terrorism laws. A powerful car bomb tore through a business district in the center of the Lebanese capital today, killing a prominent pro-Western politician and at least five other people. The assassination is certain to hike sectarian tensions already soaring because of the civil war in neighboring Syria. Former Lebanese minister Mohamed Chatta, who opposed Syrian President Bashar al-Assad, was killed. Iraqi blogger Riyad Jarar told Pacifica the bombing was an attempt to send a political message.
Many people are comparing what's going on now to the Lebanese civil war, where political messages are starting to be sent through car bombs rather than TV channels.
The blast, which wounded more than 70 others, set cars ablaze, shredded trees, and shattered windows in a main street of the posh downtown Beirut area of five-star hotels, luxury high-rises, and high-end boutiques. It sent a column of thick black smoke above the nearby government headquarters and the seafront. The lawyer for the family of 13-year-old Jahai McMath, who was declared brain dead after complications from tonsil surgery, says Jahai's relatives want to transfer her to a nursing home that's willing to continue caring for her. But lawyer Christopher Dolan said Thursday that doctors at Children's Hospital Oakland need to insert breathing and feeding tubes into the girl before the nursing home can take her. Dolan declined to name the care facility, but said it's located in the San Francisco Bay Area and is not equipped to perform surgeries. Children's Hospital wants to take Jahai off life support, a move her family opposes.
Children's Hospital does not believe performing surgical procedures on the body of a deceased person is an appropriate medical practice.
That was hospital spokesperson Sam Singer. A judge this week gave the hospital permission to proceed after 5 p.m. on Monday. Jahai's mother has until that time to appeal the decision. A San Francisco Superior Court judge heard arguments yesterday on two separate bids for preliminary injunctions blocking accreditation for San Francisco's community college, CCSF. The two injunction requests were submitted by City Attorney Dennis Herrera and by the California Federation of Teachers and its affiliate, American Federation Teachers, Local 2121. A preliminary injunction would remain in effect until a full trial is held on the claims. Robert Bezemek, an attorney representing the California Federation of Teachers and the City College Teachers Union, says there's an urgent need for an injunction to help save San Francisco City College.
An injunction's important right now, and the reason it's important is that people are bailing out, and they know that there's a disaccreditation date of July 2014, and an injunction will give them hope, because an injunction will only issue if the court finds that we are likely to prevail on the merits. If we prevail on the merits, then there would be a redo. They would start with a fair evaluation team with fair standards. That didn't happen. They would return the situation to show cause status. It would end the disaccreditation date. Ideally, it would give a new review to City College.
San Francisco City College has about 85,000 students and is one of the largest community colleges in the nation. Enrollment has dropped by 30% since last spring, when the Accrediting Commission said the community college would have to close in July 2014. Two members of the Russian punk band Pussy Riot, who spent nearly 2 years in prison for their protest in Moscow's main cathedral, said today they still want to topple President Vladimir Putin. During a two-hour press conference in Moscow, Nadezhda Tolokonikova and Maria Alekhina said they've dissolved their band and are moving on to other things, including opposing Russia's Winter Olympics. Band member Maria Alekhina.
What we want to attract attention to, first of all the attention of the people living abroad, is that they should not go to the Olympics as if it's some sport or cultural event. Think of it as a political event. Make your political choice, and if this choice is positive and you decide to come, just remember that there are people here in Russia, Russian citizens, who do not have this opportunity because they're behind bars and for no reason.
The two women lambasted the law adopted this year that bans so-called propaganda supporting non-traditional sexual orientations from being made available to minors. And weather forecast for the San Francisco Bay Area, mostly cloudy with highs in the mid-60s. In Fresno and the central San Joaquin Valley, partly cloudy with highs in the upper 60s. And it's another spare-the-air day, the fifth in a row and 20th of the season. Burning is prohibited indoors and out. I'm Cameron Jones. More headlines at noon. And please be sure to join us at 6 for the Pacifica Evening News. The Morning Mix is next.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Our first guest today is Danny Schechter. He's produced and directed 6 documentary films about Nelson Mandela and was the only American documentary filmmaker Mandela trusted to be part of his team in the United States and in South Africa after his release and his election as South Africa's president. Danny Schechter is also a longtime independent journalist, has a weekly radio show, and writes The News Dissector as a media critic. Danny Schechter joins us by phone from New York City. Danny, welcome to the program.
Pleasure.
Danny, given that you have been so involved with Nelson Mandela, and of course this book shows that, could you just tell our listeners a little bit what brought you to writing this book? And again, it's interesting timing in terms of your completion.
Well, I was invited to South Africa by the producers of the movie Mandela Long Walk to Freedom that actually is released nationwide on Christmas Day. And it's a film based on his book, Long Walk to Freedom. you know, a big mega movie like Gandhi in scale. And while I was brought down to document the making and the meaning of the movie, in other words, not simply talk to the cast of the movie, but the original cast of the struggle itself. And in the course of those interviews, because I had had a lot of experience as the producer of the South Africa Now television series that aired for 3 years from 1988 to 1991 and made these documentaries, I knew a lot about the story, and I was interested to try to find what I didn't know, to ask some questions about, to get information from the people closest to Mandela, as well as draw on my own earlier interviews with him. And that's the basis of the book. Seven Stories Press put it out. I wrote it in June. It was out in October, which is a quick turnaround, as you know. And it's also been released in South Africa. It's got some good reviews there, which is particularly welcome, given the fact that, as you would imagine, South African writers think they know the whole story and don't think Americans do at all. You know. But nevertheless, I felt like I was trying to get at some issues that haven't been very well covered about Madiba, as he's known in South Africa, his history, his background, his culture, and many traits that often are reduced in our media to a stereotype. You know, he's the man that you know, made nice to the whites. He's the man who freed South Africa. Not true. You know, in other words, history tends to be written from the top down. The great presidents, the great leaders are the focus, not the masses of the people, not the movements. And Mandela was a movement man. He was a member of the African National Congress. He worked in politics for 67 years. He was a lawyer. He was an activist in a nonviolent movement. He became the leader of a armed struggle in the ANC, some Kato Wesizwe. He was arrested for sabotage. He was sent to Robben Island for a life sentence, nearly killed, and became, you know, a larger-than-life figure, you know, a hero to millions. But also, as we see now, he's a hero to the whole world. I was at the United Nations. This was on the 19th of December. The General Assembly invited me to a special session honoring Mandela, and all these different countries spoke about his significance to them, countries like Venezuela, Cuba, Bolivia, and many countries in Africa, who added a perspective about him and why they felt he was such an important leader. That doesn't mean that he was not flawed in a way that many are, that he wasn't co-opted in some ways by power and by patronage of important people who sucked up to him. But in essence, you know, he has the respect that he has is because he is perceived as a person of high integrity and deep commitment. And I think that that's important, although there are issues involving his presidency and his movement that I did not avoid in this book. I get into neoliberalism, economic negotiations, corruption in South Africa, a lot of the current issues that, you know, are disillusioning so many, not only there but here.
Danny, hi, this is Peter Phillips. It's pretty clear that with apartheid's ending, Nelson Mandela becoming president, that inequality continued in many ways in South Africa and has gotten worse, like it has all over the world, because of neoliberal policies. How did Nelson Mandela address that or deal with that?
Well, that's a, you know, very good question. First of all, he was a politician, not an economist, okay? His major thrust followed the line given by Kwame Nkrumah, the first, you know, independent black president in Africa, you know, who said, seek ye first the political kingdom. And their hope, and I think maybe a bit naive now in retrospect, was that if they could capture state power, they would be able to promote economic policies that were more in keeping with their kind of populist orientation. And the slogan of the 1994 election was a better life for all. they were very keen about trying to do some redistribution of wealth. South Africa had, at that stage, the highest level of inequality in the world, and it may still have the highest level, although the United States is quickly challenging South Africa for that designation, and Brazil right behind them. So, you know, this is, as you point out, a major issue. But when they came to power, and right before they came to power, their main concern was to prevent and block a counter-revolution, a right-wing putsch or coup. When I sat with Joe Slovo, who's the head of the Communist Party in Johannesburg, when he just got back into the country, and I said, Joe, what are you worried about most now? He didn't talk to me so much about South Africa, but about Chile. About what happened in the aftermath of the Pinochet coup and what happened in Nicaragua when the Sandinistas lost an election. He says, we don't have the armed strength to defend ourselves against an attempted coup. And there were 30,000 armed soldiers of the old apartheid state run by generals who were, you know, fascists, to put it nicely, you know, supporters of apartheid. So they had a reality that they were dealing with at that time. They also had, to their surprise, I think, support from the United States, Great Britain, many countries in Europe who had never really supported the anti-apartheid struggle. It was only until, you know, it was only in the year 2008 that Mandela got off the terrorist list in America. And this was 18 years after he was released from prison. And after he had already been president for a term, he was still on that list. So, you had the antipathy of sections and sectors in all of these countries who had aligned themselves with the apartheid regime earlier, and now were their, quote, friends. But at the same time, you know, they were facing a need to get jobs, to get economic investment, and all the rest of it. One of the things they discovered was that the old government, the Afrikaner government, had basically stolen all the money. The treasury was bare, and they had given money in loans to big banks, so-called lifeboats, to tide them over the transition, loans that were never recovered. And the ANC found out that it would have to pay the debt, the apartheid debt that the old regime had run up by spending 10% of the GNP on military needs to repress the people in South Africa. So they were dealing with a very difficult situation, in a situation where they didn't control yet state power. There was a joint committee, the TEC of the Afrikaners and the ANC, and they had to get money, and they went to the World Bank and the IMF, who naturally enough said, okay, we'll give you the money, but on a few conditions. First, all of you, ANC and the old government, have to unanimously agree on the terms that we're imposing on you, okay? They didn't have a choice in many ways. The second part of it was what they were being asked to accept is the Washington consensus, that's C-O-N with what I call consensus, you know, that they sort of had no alternative to, because they needed this money to keep the country going, and they really didn't have the infrastructure economically to really deal with this properly. Because, you know, don't forget, all of this happened very, very quickly. Mandela was released from prison. It had been 5 years, but all of a sudden the announcement was made by the clerk on the 2nd of February. He was released on the 11th of February. And the armed struggle was the MK, the Mkhonto we Sizwe, Spear of the Nation, was legalized. Okay, we had to run an armed struggle in a legal manner. Okay, and the Communist Party was legalized, and so all of these people came back to South Africa, many without jobs, many without a clear notion of what they would be doing, but they did negotiate with their former enemies and did come up with the basis of an election, which they won in 1994. So, I'm not justifying any of this, but I'm trying to explain it. In my book, I get into something that hasn't really been reported before: top secret economic negotiations at the same time that very public political negotiations were taking place on television and being hailed to their transparency. Never happened like this before, that all the parties could speak and be seen. You know, in my book, I get into top secret economic negotiations that haven't been reported before, between the Afrikaners and the ANC that took place 6 months before the election of 1994, in which the World Bank, corporate consultants, and foreign governments were all pressuring the ANC to abandon any sort of strategy of nationalization, to accept a kind of neo-colonial economic order. And they didn't have a lot of options at the time. Don't forget, the Soviet Union had collapsed. Cuba, who had been a great ally of theirs and fighting in Angola, was itself an economic crisis. And so they had to go for the best deal they could get. And in the end, the implications of that deal have, in a sense, sealed their fate in terms of dealing with this problem. And it also has led to a lot of corruption inside South Africa and inside the ANC. So you have, real people who are committed to making change in over their heads in some ways, dealing with very sophisticated economic people. Let me give you an example, Peter. You'll like this, okay? They had these consultants, and they would say, listen, guys, here are the choices. They created these scenarios. They said, there's the Icarus option, that is to say, you demand everything, you want it all now, and then, as in the Greek story of Icarus, you end up, basically landing up in the sun, and your wings melt, and you're dead. Or you take the flamingo option. Flamingos, as birds, take off slowly, and they fly for a long period of time. Doesn't that make more sense? Because this is not something you can do overnight, blah, 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 blah. This was a period with a lot of pressure on them to produce for their people. And this is the deal that went down. And what happened was that not only the U.S. and the Britain were pushing the ANC to accept this deal and the World Bank, but also the socialist bloc, what was left of it, the communists in China and in Vietnam were all saying, listen, guys, and this happened later at a famous encounter at the World Economic Forum. They were told, listen, you better dump this antipathy to a market economy, because if you don't, all these so-called allies are going to turn on you. They were probably right about it, but it's like, what choices do you have? And I think the analysis of this is very important. I just wrote a long piece in truthdig.com about the coming of neoliberalism to South Africa. So I'm not in my sort of admiration for Madiba, I'm not soft-pedaling these issues and conflicts and problems in my Madiba A to Z. I touch on these problems. I mean, it's not a PhD thesis. I'm writing something which I hope will be a popular good read, and that's the feedback I've gotten. I've broken it down into A to Z chapters with, A being athlete, and T being terrorist, and, all the different faces of Mandela and the different contradictions that he was coping with. That's what made it so fascinating to me, even as someone who knew a lot about him and had actually, walked alongside him. One of the incidents, by the way, one of the chapters is called Indigenous, and talks about how most people on the left didn't recognize, didn't really think it was that important that he was this tribal person, an indigenous leader, and in Oakland, California, the final stop in his 1990 tour, some Native Americans from the Bay Area gave him a gift and a letter asking him to speak out on the conditions that Native Americans face in the United States. And, they didn't know if he had received the message or what have you. It was crazy, high security, et cetera, and so forth. But during his speech, he interrupted his prepared text in Oakland and spoke, to the plight of Native Americans, and actually said he would come back and take a tour of Native American reservations in America. This horrified the ANC. They say, you what? This is not in the plan, and this is interfering in the internal affairs of the United States, And the Native Americans, I went and found them the next day in Oakland. They were so thrilled that he had put this issue on the agenda. And this issue comes out of his life. So even though he was very sophisticated, known to all the presidents and royalty of the world, he chose to be buried in his ancestral homeland in Kunu, in the Eastern Cape, a rural area in South Africa. So that pull of his past was very much part of him as well. And one of the premises of that pull, by the way, which is maybe some relevance to what's happening in Pacifica Radio, they deeply believed in reaching consensus. You know, that was what he was brought up with. That's why he said he always believed in collective leadership, that he consulted with his comrades on decisions that he made. That's the fascinating part of him. He was not the savior. Every time anyone spoke of him as the man with the magic wand who freed South Africa, he would repudiate that and say, clearly, that's not what happened. You know, I'm part of a team. I'm part of the ANC. He was a movement man. And this, of course, has been distorted by the media, who offered no, you know, respect. And even by the ANC, if you noticed, even at the funeral, there were very few white comrades speaking there, although they had been part of this struggle. So these issues are still being fought out and fought over in South Africa and, of course, in our own country.
We're speaking with Danny Schechter, American journalist, documentary filmmaker, most recently author of Madiba, A to Z, The Many Faces of Nelson Mandela. And I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. You're listening to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. Danny Schechter, you just brought up the media, and that's where I wanted to go next. The U.S. media in particular, there was so much really left out, like you illustrate, in terms of, you know, who Mandela was, certainly the legacy of apartheid, the support for apartheid within the United States.
And the fact that he was arrested with
the CIA.
The CIA.
Yeah, talk about that.
It was not even mentioned, okay, no. British intelligence, you know, that the United States, the New York Times reported this. This is what's so cool. They reported it. They interviewed this guy. AP found the CIA officials, said, yeah, this was our proudest moment. We turned this terrorist over to the South African government, okay? By the time the New York Times wrote its obit, page one, they seemed to didn't even read their own coverage and didn't mention it, you know, as if it was insignificant. So, you know, of course, history is often distorted. And you know, Mandela, because he had such appeal to so many, you know, was a kind of a hero for all and was treated that way. And the specifics of his political upbringing and his strategic sense and his role as a lawyer and his role as a leader was very rarely referenced at all. And, of course, the first time there was a distraction, oh, look at Obama. He's taking a picture of himself, a selfie. Let's spend the next 10 hours discussing that. Or, you know.
Or Duck Dynasty or whatever else.
Yeah, or here's some people booing the President Zuma. Well, surprise, there's an election in South Africa. A lot of people don't like Zuma. Is that a surprise? But everything all the other leaders said was barely covered, barely referenced, barely mentioned. That's why being at the General Assembly was so interesting to me, to actually hear the substance of the remarks of all these different countries, including Jamaica, by the way. Jamaica gets up there and says, we want to give credit to Bob Marley and Peter Tosh, whose songs stimulated the anti-apartheid movement. You know what I mean? Somebody else quoted the representative of Malaysia, quoted Stevie Wonder. I mean, it was an interesting recognition of the power of popular culture. I was one of the organizers of the Sun City Project, which actually helped bring about the economic sanctions, a cultural boycott that led to the economic sanctions. But who does the New York Times cover? CNN? Paul Simon, the one guy that broke the boycott. He's in the news, you know. Suddenly he's a big admirer of Mandela, you know what I mean? Because he has a picture with him. So this is the reality that those of us who follow these issues closely need to recognize, that the media is and will distort the reality, and we have to learn more Indeed. About it for ourselves. Hence this effort with this book and with my films about Madiba.
Danny, even Bill O'Reilly has a saying that Mandela was a great, great man, even if he was still a communist. But I wanted to ask you about the Truth and Reconciliation Commission.
Yeah.
They really had to deal with the potential of a bloodbath, actually, in South Africa, certainly in the early 90s. The Truth and Reconciliation Commission was established very publicly to try to address some of the most grievous incidences and things that had happened there. Was there a behind-the-scenes aspect of that, like there
was?
Well,
I went to one of their sessions. The session I went to was really fascinating, and nobody reported. Was the ANC abuses in the ANC's military camps, which was being brought before the TRC. So it wasn't just the crimes committed by the old regime. There were also reports of the crimes committed by people in the movement, including Winnie Mandela. But you see, there was a lot of frustration there because, of course, people wanted some sort of sense of justice. They wanted that the perpetrators of these crimes, the people that killed their children and their members of their family, be punished. And you know, the official ethic was if these people disclosed their crimes, they could apply for amnesty, and many did. And I talk about that in my book also, in the case of a young girl, Amy, oh God, why am I blanking out on the last name, who Mamie Beale, you know, who was an activist who went to South Africa to be part of the voter registration effort and was murdered by a group of fanatical black nationalist types who didn't know who she was and didn't know anything else really very much except some slogans. And her parents and her family had to deal with this whole issue. What do we do? You know, our daughter has been killed. And they said, well, what would she have wanted? She would have wanted us to do to come to help build reconciliation and try to prevent a race war. So, you know, this is something that's very personal and very difficult as well as a social phenomenon, but it has had an impact at the UN. The representative of East Timor, formerly East Timor, now Timor-Leste, spoke and said the TRC in South Africa helped them come up with a formula for trying to build reconciliation with the people from Indonesia who had occupied their country. So, you know, South Africa's influence was global and is global, not just local. And this is something that many South Africans don't even realize, the degree to which the ideas that Nelson Mandela, Bishop Tutu, and others put forth have resonated around the world and certainly deserve to be scrutinized, but also deserve to be understood.
Well, Danny Schechter, I'm afraid we're out of time for this segment, but your new book, Madiba, A to Z, The Many Faces of Nelson Mandela, is available on Seven Stories Press, and it is a fascinating
Amazon,
thing.
And although we should mention Amazon, because they're in business with the CIA, I guess.
That's right, so we won't mention them.
You know, Powell's and many other online news, you know, stores, rather bookstores have this, and it's in many other bookstores. So we're trying to get this book out. There's a website, MadibaBook.com, MadibaBook.com, where there's more information and some of the press about it as well.
Thanks so much, Danny Schechter, for joining us today, and certainly like to have you back on another time.
Please, and thank you, and great luck with the work of Project Censored. More important by the minute. Okay.
Thanks, Danny.
Thanks, Danny.
Welcome back to the Project Censored Show on Pacifica Radio. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. We continue our program today on Nelson Mandela, Legacy of Apartheid. And we are joined now by Dr. Amer Arame, who teaches political science at Diablo Valley College in the San Francisco Bay Area. Amer was also a member of the United Nations Center Against Apartheid in the 1970s. He was with the United Nations for 20 years, 14 of those years. Amer Arame worked to end apartheid in South Africa, and we are joined by Amer today. Amer, welcome to the Project Censored Show.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this show, and I hope that the listeners would enjoy what we are going to say about South Africa and the legacy of Nelson Mandela.
Well, Amer Arame, tell us about your time at the United Nations and how you got involved in the movements to end apartheid in you were there for 14 years.
I was a delegate to the United Nations, and I was dealing with African issues. Then I understood that the Center Against Apartheid was interested in a political and diplomatic skills to deal with the question of South Africa and the isolation of South Africa. When I was delegate, I was calling for the isolation of South Africa and imposing sanctions. Therefore, I was recruited to this position as responsible for sanctions against South Africa in the Center Against Apartheid. And part of that responsibility was also to study the relationship between different states that were collaborating with the apartheid regime. And I was issuing the reports. Of course, I was doing the reports, but my reports were taken by the United Nations Special Committee Against Apartheid, and those reports were adopted by the committee and ultimately were submitted to the General Assembly of the United Nations.
Well, in your time in the United Nations, again, describe for the listeners what that was like. I mean, there, you know, countries like the United States and others, you know, really supported what was going on in apartheid in South Africa for some time.
Yeah, of course, they were criticizing the work of the United Nations against apartheid, and the argument used that you are trying to. We were accused of being involved in a project to destroy the white community in South Africa. And we said that was not our intention. Our intention is to help end the system of apartheid and to provide equal opportunities to all sectors of the society, because apartheid was considered as a crime against humanity. And the government of South Africa was practicing apartheid against its own people and dividing them into Bantustans and to restrict the movement of the black majority, and they were living in desperate conditions. Therefore, we said we were not against the white minority, but we want to end the system of apartheid.
Amir, of the nations that were supporting the apartheid position of South Africa, Israel was very much involved, both in terms of military support. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah. Israel was involved in military collaboration with South Africa. And I just want to mention a few of the facts which we have, and we were presenting them through the reports to the United Nations General Assembly. There were visits between military and political leaders of Israel, exchange of visits between the military and political leaders in both countries. Ariel Sharon went to Namibia in 1982 to help the South African regime to consolidate its control over Namibia. There were military collaboration and sales of weapons, etc., but the most dangerous was the nuclear collaboration. The Israeli government and its supporters here, unfortunately, in the United States and Western Europe, were denying this, and they were saying that was a campaign to delegitimize Israel. We said it is not a question of campaign against Israel. These are facts, and they continue to deny these facts. As a matter of fact, in 1979, there were a report of a nuclear test, and it was done by South Africa and Israel. But all the Western governments refused to accept this fact. And fortunately, we were proved to be right, because after the liberation of South Africa, the new government in South Africa recognized and revealed the extent of military and nuclear collaboration between Israel and South Africa.
We're speaking with Dr. Amir Arim, adjunct professor of political science at Diablo Valley College, former UN senior political affairs officer. Amir Arim spent 20 years at the UN, 14 of which working to end apartheid. You're also, Amir, author most recently of an article on the dailycensored.com, the Project Censored blog, Nelson Mandela and the Middle East. And you just started talking a little bit about that connection there. You write in the article, during the days of the struggle against apartheid, side, there was a close cooperation between the PLO, the Palestinian Liberation Organization, and the African National Congress of South Africa, the ANC. Could you talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I was informed by the representatives of the African National Congress of South Africa and the United Nations that they were having close cooperation with the Palestine Liberation Organization, and they were coordinating their activities, whether in the United Nations or outside the United Nations. And even Nelson Mandela, after his release from prison, he recognized and appreciated the cooperation between the PLO and the ANC. And these are facts. And why? Because the people of South Africa were suffering, as the Palestinian people were suffering from oppression, repression, and they saw that those two regimes in Tel Aviv and in Pretoria were collaborating in the military and other fields, and both of these regimes were directing their policies to oppress the people, and all what they are demanding, whether the people of South Africa or the people of Palestine, were demanding that their human rights should be respected, their political rights should be respected, they should be part of the system, and they should. This is democracy. We here in the West, we are speaking about democracy, but when democracy came to South Africa during the apartheid regime, they said no. The white government was an ally of the West, and therefore we should not attack it. Until the popular movement in the United States and in West Europe changed the whole situation. Why? Because people put pressure on Congress. Do you know that the 1986 Anti-Apartheid Act was passed by Congress, but President Ronald Reagan vetoed that act. But because of the political pressure from anti-apartheid groups in the United States, students groups, women movement, labor unions, etc., etc., all these people put pressure on members of Congress, and that was one of the rare occasions that a veto by President Ronald Reagan was overruled. Congress was able to override the veto by President Ronald Reagan with respect to sanctions against South Africa. After those sanctions were adopted by Congress in the United States and by the European countries, then the South African regime began to realize that the game is changing. And step by step, they agreed on the independence of Namibia. Then ultimately, they tried to end, to come to negotiations. At the beginning, they promised, as I said before, they promised Nelson Mandela that he would be released. But he said that you have to end the system of apartheid. The cooperation between Israel and South Africa is a reality now. Many Israeli politicians nowadays are saying that they are having the same system as the system of apartheid in South Africa.
So they're saying that Israel now is the apartheid state and South Africa has moved beyond. And part of that, too, was the use of nuclear technologies and the creation of a bomb for South Africa during the time when they had actually invaded Angola. And there was some consideration of using nuclear weapons in that fight because South Africa was not being successful. And one of the reasons they weren't successful was that Cuba had come in and was there for 15 years or so in support of the Angolan movements. So it's not an accident that Raul Castro is at the funeral
Obama shakes his hand. That, of course, upsets some people. But it was a clear acknowledgement that Cuba had been very involved there for a long time.
Yes, yes, and it was very well-known fact in the United Nations at that time and today that Cuba played an important role in stopping South Africa from invading Angola.
We're speaking with Dr. Amira Rame, adjunct professor, political science at Diablo Valley College, former UN senior political affairs officer, author of numerous articles on the Middle East, Palestine. But for 14 of his 20 years at the United Nations, Amira Rame worked to help end apartheid. And where do you see this going, Amira Rame, in the wake here of the funeral for Mandela? You know, a lot of the media coverage in the United States has really left out a lot of the things that we're getting at here today on the program. Our earlier guest, Andy Schechter, talked a lot about that. And, of course, the CIA was involved in arresting Mandela, putting him in prison in the first place. There's a dark part of that history that it seems that people would like to forget.
Of course. Even I think President Ronald Reagan said that South Africa was the ally of the West and it stood with the West in all its wars, and we should not abandon South Africa at this moment. That was a known statement to President Ronald Reagan. The same thing with Margaret Thatcher. She was really adamantly against sanctions, but the people of the United States and the people of Britain were able to change the situation by their demands, by putting tremendous pressure on legislatures in both countries, and ultimately that was the beginning of the end of apartheid.
So what you're saying is that it's part of this sanctions movement, and we see a similar sanctions movement gaining some ground here vis-a-vis Israel-Palestine, the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement.
Yes.
Would you say a word?
And I am glad that you are mentioning that. I would like to salute the American Studies Association for their academic boycott of Israel, because that is an important step toward sending a message to the Israeli government that even if the Western governments are not in a position to put pressure, the peoples of the United States, of Europe, and every other part of the world should be united and send a message to Israel. Israel will not have normal relations with other parts of the world if it continues to oppress and repress the Palestinian people. Gaza is under siege by Israel. There were floods in Gaza, and nobody was able to provide any humanitarian assistance to the people of Gaza because of the siege of Israel. The situation in the West Bank, the demolition of houses, the expulsion of Palestinians, the checkpoints, all these measures are exactly what the South African regime was doing. And the international community should support the boycott movement. And I want to send a message to some of the Israeli supporters here in the United States. I want to tell them that this is not against the Jewish people. We respect the Jewish people. The Jewish voice for peace here in the United States and other parts of the world are calling for sanctions in order to send a message to the Israeli government that they must withdraw from the West Bank and they should allow the Palestinians to exercise their right to self-determination.
So we've been speaking with Dr. Amira Rame, adjunct professor of political science, Diablo Valley College, formerly at the United Nations, working to end apartheid. And again, you also write a good deal about trying to end the apartheid system in Israel concerning Palestine. So Amira Rame, we have about 1 minute left in this segment. What would you like to say to wrap up this segment from the legacy of apartheid
Mandela? I would like to thank you, first of all, for having me on this program. Second, I would like you to support the movement here in the United States to have sport boycott, cultural boycott, and academic boycott of Israel. And furthermore, there are certain corporations here in the United States are involved in investment in the Jewish settlements in the West Bank. These settlements are against international law in accordance with the United States policy. Although now, unfortunately, the Obama administration is no longer speaking about that, but all U.S. administrations in the past said that the Israeli settlements in the West Bank are against international law. Therefore, investing or trading with these settlements, Israeli settlements in the West Bank, is contrary to international law, and we ask people to boycott all products that are brought to this country from the Israeli settlement in the West Bank.
We know all too well that our freedom is incomplete without the freedom of the Palestinians, said Nelson Mandela. You can learn more about this at bdsmovement.net. Thank you very much, Dr. Amir Arame, for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me. Have a good day.
That does it for today's show on Nelson Mandela and the Legacy of Apartheid. I'm Mickey Huff with Peter Phillips. Special thanks to Anthony Fest. You're listening to the Project Censored Show on The Morning Mix, originating in KPFA Studios, Berkeley, California. For archives of our shows, visit projectcensored.org. Please keep tabs and like us on Facebook at Project Censored. You are tuned to 94.1 FM KPFA, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Up next, Democracy Now! With Amy Goodman.
is Brian Edwards Tekert. There are a million ways that machines and algorithms have replaced the work of human beings. On January 7th, we'll ask, when is that a good thing? When is it a bad one? And what is to come? MIT scholars Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee are coming to the stage to discuss their new book, The Second Machine Age, Work, Progress, and Prosperity in a Time of Brilliant Technologies. They happen to be optimists. My job? Bring on the skeptical gloom. I'll be hosting both authors on Monday, January 27th at the Hillside Club. The address is 2286 Cedar Street in Berkeley. It's wheelchair accessible. Proceeds benefit KPFA. Tickets at local independent bookstores and brownpapertickets.com. See you there.
This is a listing of upcoming events in the Bay Area for the week ending January 5th. All events are wheelchair accessible. Please listen closely for contact numbers. On Monday, December 30th, from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m., the Oakland Museum of California hosts the exhibition Above and Below, Stories from Our Changing Bay. This event takes place at 1000 Oak Street in Oakland. For more information, call 510-318-8400. On Tuesday, December 31st at 8 p.m., Marty O'Reilly and the Old Soul Orchestra will play at the Spurs Record Release Party. This New Year's Eve bash takes place at 1050 Rivers Street in Santa Cruz. For more information, call 831-621-6226. On Sunday, January 5th from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., the Bay Area Book Exchange hosts another ever-changing treasure hunt among their thousands of books. The exchange is run by a cooperative of local booksellers and book lovers who process thousands of books every month. The event takes place at 10520 San Pablo Avenue in El Cerrito. For more information, call 510-705-1200. The community calendar is produced by members of the First Voice Apprenticeship Program. Send your listing at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704. Or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767 extension 621. This calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
Hey everyone, this is Mitch Jezerich with Letters and Politics. Hope you are doing well at the end of the year and have a great idea for the beginning of the year. And that is, come with me to see economist Richard Wolff, author of Capitalism Hits the Fan. He's going to be speaking at the First Congregational Church of Berkeley on Wednesday, January 15th at 7:30 p.m. His topic will be economic crisis and system decline, what we can do. If you're familiar with Richard Wolff, well, then you know that you can expect original, reassuringly trustworthy analysis delivered in a blunt style laced with refreshing wit. I'll be introducing Richard Wolff. It's a KPFA benefit, and it is wheelchair accessible. The church is at 2345 Channing. That's just off Dana. Advanced tickets are available at brownpapertickets.com and at our supportive independent bookstores. That's January 15th. Richard Wolff. Hope to see you there.
Holiday season, you probably support many nonprofits, and we applaud your generosity.
Remember, gifts to charitable organizations are tax deductible this year only if your gift is postmarked or completed online on or before December 31st.
Please consider including KPFA in your giving this year. Visit us at kpfa.org.
As we count down the remaining days of 2013, we at KPFA want to thank you for listening and supporting KPFA in our communities.
There's still time to make a tax-deductible donation to ensure the programs you hear on KPFA will continue to thrive in 2014.
Please make a secure gift online now at kpfa.org.
Thanks.
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 You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KSCF 88.1 in Fresno,